Good evening.
Good evening.
It's a pleasure to see you this evening. Our speaker this evening really needs no introduction, but that's not going to stop me for drumming on for 45 minutes. Oh, and now they're throwing things. Watch out. I was only joking about 45 minutes. Well, an incredible list of accomplishments and a CV. A Stanford grad, Oregon State, CDSP, biology, oceanography, scientist, pilot, church. I can't imagine the waterfront that you cover in terms of your knowledge. Also, very well published, The Heartbeat of God, A Wing and a Prayer, Gospel in the Global Village, and The Gathering at God's Table. Our 26th presiding bishop, priest in 1994, 2001, Bishop of Nevada, and 2006, presiding bishop. And we could go on and on. But I would like to introduce you as we remember you every Sunday in our prayers. Katharine, our presiding bishop, thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. It's a great joy to be here again. I was telling Isabel on the way from the airport that I think I was in this part of the world four times in 2007, as the great rounds of 400 anniversaries began. Celebrate 300 years this beginning this year, and I give great thanks for the witness of this congregation in this place for three centuries. That's quite a remarkable feat and legacy you have brought. I'm going to say a little bit about change in the church. Come on in, find a place to sit. And when I'm finished with some brief remarks, then I would invite conversation about whatever you would like to talk about. So I hope you think of things that you're curious about. Let me say a little bit about where we've come from and where I think we are going as the Episcopal Church. This may seem an interesting way to talk about it, but I think the sex wars are behind us. Quite clearly. Not everybody in this church agrees about decisions the General Convention has made, but people in the Episcopal Church today are willing to live with a diversity of opinion, with an understanding that we have never all agreed, and we never will before the second coming. But we are on about God's business. And I want to say that I think that intense conflict was a sign of the difficulty of dealing with the pace of change in the society around us. The sex wars were in some ways a proxy for the church's anxiety about change, over losses in the life of the church, the loss of status, the loss of position as the Episcopal Church. This congregation went through a loss like that when the church was disestablished in Virginia. And it is becoming functionally disestablished today in the United States. We enjoyed way more than our share of privilege as the Episcopal Church for centuries, and that is no longer true today. People don't come to join the Episcopal Church because that's the socially expected thing to do. People come to join this church because they want to be more deeply grounded Christians. They want an invitation to wrestle with their faith, the permission to ask questions, to grow more deeply in relationship with God and Jesus Christ. We are being healed from the conflict that we have experienced as a church by turning outward, by remembering that our primary task is to love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. And not just the people in here, not just the choir and the converted, but the people out there, our neighbors in this community and across the world. Some of you will undoubtedly have heard of the five Anglican marks of mission. Any of you? few, anyway? Good. It's a framework that the Anglican Communion has been using for the last 30 years to think about what God in Jesus has sent us into the world to do. It's helpful because no community, no individual can answer all of it alone. It requires action by the whole body of Christ, looking to heal the world into something that looks more like the reign of God, which is why Jesus came among us. Five marks of mission, and I'm going to use less than traditional language to talk about this, but the first one is really about the good news of God's love for all of us and for all creation. The second one is about building disciples. The traditional language says to teach, nurture, and baptize new believers, but it is to form Christians in a growing faith. The third mark is about humble service, responding to human need with actions that respond to what that need really is. The fourth one is about confronting injustice in the world around us. It's about making peace. It's about confronting violence. It's about helping the world to move toward that vision of shalom, where there is peace because there is justice in the world. And the fifth mark is about caring for creation. If we rewrote the prayer book today, we would include in the baptismal covenant a statement about our responsibility for the non-human parts of creation. And I have just, in the last couple of days, seen that a resolution is coming to General Convention to ask permission that we might include that on a trial basis. So the awareness is becoming widespread. We're also beginning to understand more clearly that our task as Christians is fundamentally political. Jesus was a political animal, if you will. He confronted injustice in society around him and expects us to do the same. We don't come to church to ignore what's going on in the world around us, but to be transformed so that we might help transform the injustice in the world around us. We are increasingly understanding that it's part of our Christian duty to be effective citizens in the community and to use our faith to inform the decisions we make at the ballot box or in engaging the larger society around us. I could point to things like Moral Mondays in North Carolina. Are any of you aware of that? A long history, recent history in North Carolina of trying to remove protections for people in need, trying to deconstruct a lot of the social safety net that's been created there in the last few decades. And the religious community, the leaders in religious communities are attempting to challenge the legislature about that, to produce justice for people who are poor and in need. That's one example. The Episcopal Church, in its variety, is looking for creative ways to be present in the wider community. Not every Episcopal Church has 300 years of history in one building. New congregations, new communities of faith are being planted in ways that look like the ancient church, and that we are encouraging creativity in that kind of work. I'll give you some examples. In Los Angeles, and there are several examples of this, but there's one in Los Angeles called Laundry Love. People in the congregation notice that those who live on the street or who live in very low-income housing have no place to wash their clothes. So they turn up at a laundromat once a month with quarters and detergent and clean bags and help people to do their laundry. Out of that has grown a worshiping community. And so much so that a person has been ordained to serve in that community. It is the church leaving its safe pews and comfortable church to go out in the community and listen to what the need is, and then to find a response that gives people an example of what God's love looks like in action. I met somebody yesterday who's part of something called Dinner Church. A group of young adults, the one I know about, started in Manhattan, Lutheran and Episcopal young adults, cooking dinner together. And out of that has grown a worshiping community that meets in rented space or moves from home to home, that has been in existence for a number of years. You know something about groups like this through campus ministry, pizza offerings that gather students. It answers a need for community, often for food, for fellowship, that is present in the community that's appropriate to the need. Theology on tap, meeting in a tavern or a bar, literally, to invite people to wrestle with the deep spiritual questions in their lives. It's a way for the church to be present in an environment where people, lots of unchurched people get really nervous about coming to a place like this. It's a lot easier to engage in a neutral environment where someone is willing to listen to what the questions are. 12-step programs have for years brought people into churches for spiritual growth in ways that didn't necessarily mean Sunday morning church. Some congregations are looking at housing in their neighborhoods, housing needs. St. Mary's Episcopal Church in Anchorage has a large plot of land, and they have decided to use some of that land to build housing for low and middle income seniors. That kind of housing is almost non-existent in Anchorage. They will provide that housing for a very low rent. They will provide an opportunity to build community, as much connection with the church as people are interested in, and some community of support as people age in place. A church in St. Paul's in Savannah, Georgia, looked at the need in the neighborhood, discovered that there were lots of row house kinds of housing that weren't adequate to the need. They bought and rehabbed a number of those buildings and provided low and moderate income housing in that place. Trinity Wall Street is beginning to do that kind of work in Manhattan, where there is a terrible dearth of low and middle income housing. Sometimes the need is about childcare or parenting needs. St. James Church in Kapalama, Washington, on the Columbia River, 30 years or so ago, a woman in the congregation looked around and said, the dairy industry has fallen apart, the fishing industry has collapsed, the lumber industry is gone, women who've stayed at home with children are going back to school or going back to work. Some distance from this community, they need childcare. She went to the vestry and said, well, if you can give me 2 Sunday school rooms and we can find 7 children, I think we can break even. This is a congregation of 20 or 25 people. It's still 20 or 25 people. But the St. James Family Center they have established today is the 3rd largest employer in the county. It provides Head Start programming, after-school programming, parent classes. It runs the domestic violence shelter for the county. It is a major impact to the community. They are building the reign of God in that place through the ministry of the St. James Families. Other ways that communities of faith are beginning to gather. In New England, there are a couple of examples where people come together for church basically in the woods. They hike together. Out of that is growing a worshiping community. They encounter God's creativity in the natural world, which is inescapable in a season like this. And out of that, people who have been unchurched or de-churched are finding spiritual community in the home. We're encouraging people all across the Episcopal Church to think creatively about how the gifts that we know in this tradition can be shared with people who don't know about them. In the coming years, I think we're going to see more communities like that that may not have permanent buildings, that may not have full-time paid staff, that may move from site to site over the years, but that are present in the community and answering needs that may not look like the ones you're answering here. We're going to see a much greater diversity in congregational life. Let me say a little something about the diversity in the Episcopal Church. We are not a national church, and we probably haven't been a national church since relatively soon after this building was built. We are present in 17 different countries. We're in Taiwan, in Micronesia, Honduras, Ecuador, Colombia, Venezuela, which includes Curacao. Haiti is our numerically largest diocese. We're in the Dominican Republic. The British and the U.S. Virgin Islands together are a diocese. There's a diocese in Puerto Rico, which is a territory of the U.S. And the Convocation of Episcopal Churches in Europe is present in Austria, Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, and Switzerland. And the Bishop Suffragan is talking to a group of people in Poland who have translated the prayer book into Polish. Within the U.S. part of our context, we worship in a couple of dozen different languages, 19 in the Diocese of Los Angeles. The fastest growing parts of the Episcopal Church are many of our overseas dioceses, congregations in the U.S. that are working with immigrant populations and with multicultural populations, and congregations, not unlike this one, that are turned outward to address the needs of the people who are not their members. Some of you may know this famous quote from Archbishop of Canterbury in the 1940s. He said, "The church is the only institution in the world that exists primarily for the benefit of those who are not its members." We're not its members. We're meant to give ourselves away. That's really what it means to pick up your cross and to follow Jesus. I'm excited about where the Episcopal Church is and the open future before it. It's going to mean continued change, and that will challenge all of us. But it's one of the most exciting times to be an Episcopalian in the last couple of centuries, I think. We're working with our ecumenical partners and increasingly working with interreligious partners to address the needs of a hurting world. And that's what God has called us to do. What would you like to talk about? Please.
Thank you very much for being here.
You're welcome.
It's a great pleasure to ask a question that's been on my heart for some time. And that has to do with the, I think it was the 92 GC resolution on the synod issue. And I say that because I wonder whether that can be reinvigorated or reestablished. As the chairman of the Anti-Racism Commission in the Diocese for a number of years, we reached a point where we sort of, members gave up, and sort of the diocese gave up on the training and the teaching, seeing the face of God in each other. And we haven't done that in an intentional way for some time. And we didn't get, we got good support from Jane Mason, the church center, and then I heard that that was closed, or that was shut down, or that was
and what as a church we can do to invigorate, encourage, support work in a diocese and in local congregations. There is a committee of the Executive Council responsible for anti-racism. It's been quite vigorous in the last year. It's bringing a number of resolutions to General Convention. There was some happy synchronicity. The committee met in February and March. The House of Bishops met in March. I knew what was coming, and I asked the House of Bishops if they would write a new pastoral letter on the sin of racism. They've agreed to do that, and it should be promulgated about a year from now. Given the reality, the reality of police violence, police use of force that we're seeing across the U.S. today, and it's not just in the U.S., it happens in other countries as well, is awakening people to the institutional racism, the systemic racism that we still live with. A resolution from General Convention a couple ago asked each diocese to form its own committee and to have a service of repentance or recognition of the sin of racism. A number of dioceses have done that with very powerful effect. I think I can tell this story here. The Diocese of Louisiana had scheduled a service like that in early in January of 2014. And it was on my schedule to go there. And the bishop called up and said, you know, 6 months or so ahead of time, no, we have not done our work. We're not ready to do this. Come later. We're going to reschedule this. They took another year and did an amazing piece of work. It's not easy work. But our own vulnerability to having the conversations, discovering the ways in which all of us are blind about the reality of racism all around us is an important part of our spiritual journey. I was part of a pilgrimage to Ghana with Episcopal Relief and Development in February. As part of that, we visited a slave camp, a former slave camp in northern Ghana, and the castles on the coast from which slaves were shipped. They're prominently evident in the series called Roots, and a couple of other films like Amistad. It's incredibly moving to go there and see the reality of what human beings have done to one another. And at the same time, to witness the healing that can happen as people go and experience that and have conversations and lament together about the reality of our human sin. How do we best support you? There is a network of anti-racism trainers across the Episcopal Church. I can put you in touch with members of that committee who I know would welcome the opportunity to have conversation and strategize with you. Some of you have seen Traces of the Trade, a film called Traces of the Trade. It's a very powerful story of the largest slave trading family in the United States who were in Rhode Island, who produced a presiding bishop, a number of clergy, and slave traders, and sometimes they were the same people. Dane and Constance Perry, he is a descendant of that family, came and fostered a discussion at the House of Bishops meeting in March. It was very, very powerful and effective. That'd be a great place to start, and I know that Dane and Constance would be overjoyed to come and do that with you.
Please.
When do you anticipate we will have a new prayer book? And what direction would it be headed?
When do I anticipate we will have a new prayer book, and in what direction do I think it will be heading? We've been adding to the prayer book for 40 years. We've been adding little pieces. I think one of the big questions is whether we will actually print another prayer book. I know, that's given the way we deal with information today, whether we will actually publish whole books, I don't know. The Church of England has done significant revision for their, or addition to their services. There's still parishes that use the 1662, quite a few of them. But their authorized worship, I think is what it's called now, the most recent version, is mostly available online. People download the pieces they want to use and produce a bulletin for a particular Sunday. I think we're going to see more of that. I'm going to encourage the General Convention this summer to start that process. As I observed about the baptismal covenant, there are pieces in it that are dated. We're still learning the theology in this prayer book. We don't want to let go of that. We still have lots more to learn. But there are a number of things that need updating, that need correcting, that need expanding. The language for God in there is pretty limited to a very small chunk of what's in the Bible. There are 100 names for God in the Bible, and I don't know, half a dozen appear in that prayer. I think it's going to be, the next version will have more options. We'll have options to address the variety of kinds of faith communities that I talked about earlier. That's one of the challenges that we have right now. I can't predict much more beyond that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Please, in the back.
With regard to ecumenicism.
Yes.
We had the communion, official communion.
Yes.
Is there anything new on the horizon that's coming up? Because I think it's really, it's a scandal. Diversity of quote Christianity. So could you just inform us a little bit of what's going on?
Yes, great question. He's asking about ecumenical relations and moves toward full communion, noting that the Evangelical Lutheran Church is our full communion partner. We're also in full communion with the Moravian Church. There are quite a few Moravians in North Carolina and in a couple of other parts of the United States. Most of the Moravians in the world are in Tanzania and Nicaragua. They are a great gift to us. They're an even more ancient part of the Reformation than we are. There are some joint ministries in North Carolina, and I think one in Pennsylvania at this point. That's an emerging reality. We're in interim Eucharistic sharing with the United Methodist Church. We're beginning a new series of dialogue with the United Methodist Church. The members of those conversations are being appointed right now. It is my hope that we will get to full communion with the United Methodists sooner rather than later. There's renewed energy for it in the last 6 months even. But it takes coming to know one another. It takes sharing Eucharist and fellowship together. If there isn't life at the grassroots level, at the local level, the talks we have as denominations will never bear fruit. So I would encourage you to work together with the Methodists and the Presbyterians and others in your local community to learn about one another. I think it's less likely that we're going to get to a full communion relationship with the Presbyterians in the near future, There are some formal agreements in a couple of big cities where the Episcopal Cathedral and the Roman Catholic Cathedral share baptism together at Eastertide. We do recognize each other's baptism. We don't rebaptize the Roman Catholics, and they don't rebaptize Episcopalians. We reordain each other. But there is some mutuality of ministry, and we have to continue to build on it. Please.
The question I have is just the growth of the Episcopal Church. Many younger families are more involved in non-denominational churches. And how do you see any of the traditional denominations working with that issue?
Growth in the Episcopal Church, he's observing that young families are more often involved in non-denominational churches. That's a hard judgment for me to make. That may be your experience here in this local community. The reality is that across North America, participation in church is declining. Fewer people are members of formal religious communities, and fewer people attend with the regularity that many of the people in this room grew up with. A member of an Episcopal church might come twice a month and still be an active member. Our numbers across the church are flat or slightly declining, but as I pointed out to you earlier, there are many circumstances in which we're growing significantly in terms of numbers. Young families in the culture around us, many of them simply don't have the ability to participate on a regular weekly basis. If they are both working, both parents are working, they have young children, once a month might be a really good record. Part of what churches can do, I think, is to listen to the needs of people like that and ask what would be most helpful. Maybe it's a Tuesday evening service that includes dinner rather than expectation for participation on Sunday morning. The Church of England has done something really creative. They call it messy church. For a parent with a small child to come and basically do an art project that is teaching about the gospel, teaching a Bible story. It's a community gathering. It's a time of worship in an age-appropriate fashion, but it doesn't look like Sunday morning. And it doesn't happen on Sunday morning. I think that's one of the answers that we might provide. A greater variety of openness and going out into the community to learn what the need is and what would be most helpful. Please.
Going perhaps further down the road, after 9/11, I believe the Episcopal Church engaged in some discussion with American Muslims. Yes. Could you say if such discussions are continuing and if they are effective?
Thank you. Thank you for raising that. Absolutely. Formal conversations with Muslims are challenging because they don't organize themselves the way we do. Most of those conversations are happening at the local level, where a congregation, an Episcopal congregation and a Muslim congregation meet one another, meet in each other's spaces for prayer and food usually. Food draws human beings together in a very important way. Hospitality, mutual hospitality is an opportunity for learning. The last General Convention asked me to organize an interfaith pilgrimage to the Holy Land. That happened in January. Four Muslims, three of them imams, four rabbis, half a dozen Episcopalians went to Israel-Palestine to learn about the realities on the ground. We met with politicians, we met with religious leaders, we met with peace activists, we met with business people, we met with people learning how to negotiate, teaching negotiation skills to diplomats and government officials. was a remarkably powerful experience. I think all of us came back transformed by it and transformed by the community that was built among the members. That work is expanding as I speak. We're finding new ways to engage our respective faith communities in ongoing conversation and collaboration. So, is there a mosque nearby?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Are you in conversation? Not yet? Not yet? Okay. Well. I'm aware of a number of communities where Jewish and Muslim congregations and Christian congregations together feed the hungry, house the homeless, and they fill in for each other at holiday time. You know, the Jews will cover for the Christians at Christmas, and the Christians will cover for the Muslims during Ramadan, and that kind of thing. Fantastic. Fantastic. Tell the story.
Do you want to tell the story quickly?
Please, please.
The started going to the Catholic Church, the Community of Faith Mission, and it's to house the homeless from the first part of November through the middle of March. And over this Christmas holiday, the Jewish people, the Jewish community came together and took care of the families so the Christians could worship
Thank you. it's willing to accept the gifts of people who come to join that community. It's willing to invite people into leadership as appropriate. There is an openness to learning from new members. There's an openness to learning and listening in the wider community, and there's an engagement with the wider community. The ones that seem like they're dying are the ones who are wholly inwardly focused and usually fighting about something. We are delivered from that kind of attitude by paying attention to what the needs of others are. It's when we're so self-focused that I think we descend into the abyss. What do you find most encouraging and inviting?
A lot of those things. I think there's tremendous attraction when there's beauty.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sometimes that may not be a beauty this way. It might be natural beauty or any number of different ways it could be expressed. Music, art.
Yes.
I think when there's space made for meditation, contemplation, added to some of the things she just mentioned.
Thank you. You had your hand up.
I did. I'm very proud of the Episcopal Relief Agency. And I know that when there's been a natural disaster, that their people with our funds will be around the world, whether it's the tsunami or Haiti or the tornadoes in the Midwest. But I know very little about it. Can you tell us the health of the agency, whether it's expanding, and specifically a few of their other projects?
Certainly. Episcopal Relief and Development is celebrating its 75th anniversary. It began in the midst of World War II as a resettlement agency for refugees. And in the last 15 years, it's split into two agencies, Episcopal Relief and Development and Episcopal Migration Ministry, which is resettling about 5,500 refugees a year in the United States. Episcopal Relief and Development does development work worldwide, I think in 42 countries, and it does disaster response in the U.S. and the rest of the world. It is a growing agency. When I was in Ghana in February, we visited some of the work that Episcopal Relief and Development is supporting and facilitating there. One of the things we visited, it is called a donkey plow project. It's basically a way to assist women to be farmers. In that part of the world, the traditional way of plowing is with a pair of oxen, which are expensive and are too big for most women to handle alone. Helping a woman to receive a plow, a small plow, a donkey, and a cart, a wheeled cart that the donkey can pull, allows her to be an income producer for her family, both by what she can grow and by what she can transport with the donkey and the cart to market, goods to market, and things back from market for hire for other people. It's a way of empowering women. It's having a remarkable effect there. We also visited another women's development project that has to do with handcrafts, making baskets and weaving strips of cloth that are formed into other things. The elder, the chief in this village, was sitting with the women when we went to visit, and he stood up at the beginning and said how proud he was of what the changes this was making in their community, that it was giving women confidence as they began to have the capacity to earn a little bit of money to help support their families. It was giving them skills that were a gift to everyone. And it was just remarkable. What else? Episcopal Relief and Development supports significant health projects, nets for life, malaria nets, insecticide-treated long-lasting bed nets. I think they've distributed 11 million nets in sub-Saharan Africa, which have prevented, you know, 500,000 deaths in the last few years. The work of Episcopal Relief and Development is a partnership between the organization and the local diocese, who decide what the needs are and where they would like Episcopal Relief and Development to partner. It's very much a development work that comes from the needs and desires of the local community. In the same kind of way that I spoke about being in the neighborhood and listening to what people are hungry for. Episcopal Relief and Development goes to and asks people, basically, what they want to focus on, what the community wants to focus on in its development work.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Please.
Can you address the finances of the Episcopal Church, both on a macro and a micro basis?
Okay, be a little more specific.
Macro is a big picture, micro is
well,
here.
Okay, I don't know much about the I do know something
not here,
okay.
About this church specifically, but this time.
Let me take a shot at it, and then you tell me what more you would like. The Episcopal Church is, our church-wide budget for work that we do together as a church is about $55 million a year. We adopt a budget on a triennial basis at General Convention for the next 3 years, and that will happen in late June and early July this year. We've got a significant endowment, which provides about 40% of the budget, the church-wide budget. Most of the rest of it comes from diocesan contributions to the church-wide budget. At the local level, I think most dioceses have recovered from the financial slump of 2008, which was very painful in some places. Not all of our dioceses contribute to the church-wide budget at the expected level, and that's an ongoing challenge. We could do a whole lot more if every diocese did contribute at the level it was asked to. Some are unable to financially. Places like the Diocese of Columbia or the Diocese of South Dakota, which is mostly indigenous, mostly on Native American reservations. Other dioceses choose not to contribute at the level that's asked. I think long term, over the next 10 years, we're probably going to see declining contributions to the church-wide budget. There's always this tension between what a diocese thinks it needs to do at home and what it wants to partner with the wider church to do on behalf of us all. I sit in a place where I see the needs across the church, and I deeply wish everybody contributed at levels that would allow us to encourage the flourishing of ministry on Native American reservations and in our growing dioceses in Latin America so that they might grow toward financial self-sufficiency. I noted to your rector that it's 5 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, which is probably a challenging time for young families. And so we talked about that part of the diversity challenge. And you asked about Sunday morning being the most segregated part of the week, still. I wholeheartedly agree with you. I don't know what the community, what this community looks like.
Not like this.
Not like this. Thank you. Part of that is the responsibility of the members who sit here. Do you know people of color? Do you know people who don't look like you as friends, as coworkers? Do you ever invite people to church? That's having relationships in the wider community that transcend some of the boundaries that keep human beings apart is the answer to it. And it's hard work, and it requires courage and vulnerability. And that's what stops most of us from reaching across boundaries. We're afraid at some point.
Yeah. I mean, you can do anything if you want to.
We did that.
Okay.
we're still studying. The group that's tasked with this has looked at all sorts of financial matters and things that are related to moving the headquarters, the church center. The reality is that at the present time, that building in Manhattan is occupied by several other tenants, as well as the Episcopal Church. And basically, it pays for us to be there. So the question that the committee is looking at now is what the missional need is. How would that best be answered? Our location in New York City is important to our work with the United Nations, which is a growing part of our work. We have it's called ECOSOC status. We're recognized as a social agency that is part of the dialogue of the United Nations. And we have an ability to be present in conversations and actions of the United Nations that we didn't have a year and a half ago. That doesn't require that the whole team is there. The reality also is that most of the mission staff are dispersed across the church. They live in different places. One lives in Asheville, North Carolina, one lives in Panama, one lives in Scotland, one lives in Minneapolis, one lives in Los Angeles. They work from there. They travel from their homes rather than from New York City. That's made us more available to the concerns of the wider church, and I think made us more responsive. The missional questions are being examined. I can't tell you when a decision will be made. I don't expect that a decision is going to be made before General Convention. But at the moment, people see a major advantage of moving the headquarters to Iowa or to some other part of the country. Yes, New York is a somewhat expensive place to be. It's not the most expensive place to operate. Boston and Washington are both more expensive. It's a trade-off. New York's got good connections for our interactions with other parts of the international church. With our Latin American diocese and our church in Europe, that's more difficult. You know, the diocese in Taiwan is a long way from anywhere. it's a balancing act, and we don't have an answer yet. But yes, we're still looking at it. Please.
I understand what you're saying. Sure, New Yorker. You're not just close to the United Nations. You are literally a casual walk there. Very important, talks to the issue of influencing this very, very political world, and I mean world. I just wanted to just add to you because I think that.
Thank you. We're literally two blocks from the UN. Yeah. Please.
You have talked compellingly about challenges and opportunities. Can you talk a little bit about what the challenges and opportunities of being presiding bishop have meant for you personally?
The challenges and opportunities of being presiding bishop. When I came into office, conflict was so prevalent that I saw my immediate role as being out and present physically for conversation with people in pain across the church. One of the first expectations of the presiding bishop is to visit all the dioceses of the church. And there were 112 when I started. I discovered that my predecessors hadn't managed to do that. I've gotten around to all of them, many of them several times, and that's been an important way of reminding people that we're connected. And if people are in pain over here, maybe it would help them to be connected or to know something about what people over here are doing. And how people are responding to the challenging situation. I've seen my responsibility as connecting people, building bridges between people and resources, people and others who are wrestling with similar kinds of challenges. I think the challenge of this role is always about finding some balance in the overwhelming number of situations that need attention, and how to focus that. How to focus that, and how to build a collaborative team who can help the whole church respond to the needs of a hurting world. No perfect answer. In the back.
You have mentioned a couple things about this already, but my question is a little specifically in the digital age that we're in now, and with, you know, so much is able to happen on a ground level where it hasn't before, people getting having resources, what is the future for the hierarchical organization that is found in almost all the mainline Protestant denominations?
Well, that's a wonderful question. He's asking what the future of a hierarchical church structure is in a world that's becoming much more interconnected at a ground grassroots level. I think that's part of what TREC was about, the task force to reimagine the Episcopal Church. Some people, I think, have hoped that we'll have a structural answer to fix all of that. No, I think, again, it's a proxy for the kind of chaotic reorganizing that is happening as we respond to change in the world around us. The Episcopal Church is far less hierarchical than it was when this building was built. It's far less hierarchical than it was 50 years ago. It's far less hierarchical than the church that it grew out of, which is, at the same time, Anglicanism has always made decisions bishop and synod together. Since the Reformation, we have insisted that the people have a role, all the people have a role in decision-making. And this church has brought that to a level that is almost unique in the communion, in the Anglican communion. Our focus on a distributed decision-making through general convention, through diocesan conventions or diocesan councils, that together we make decisions. At the same time, human systems need some identified leader both to shoot at and to say there's a fire over there, go! At times of crisis. That's one of the central functions of identified leadership. It's response to change, response to crisis, gathering the discernment of the body and hoping to focus it. I think that's traditionally been one of the gifts that Episcopalians have understood and valued as most central to who we are. That we do things together, and yes, we have bishops. We're named after that reality. But I think it's going to continue to be a network reality. It has to be. The body of Christ is a network reality, and the bishop is the head. Jesus is the head. But I think that's a really, really trenchant question. It will be interesting to see what this church looks like 30 years from now.
Bishop Katharine, thank you so much for I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that Bishop Katharine travels with a photographer who's also her significant other. Richard, would you please stand? At this point, we will move down to the parish house for reception. See all of you there.